I look back on my career at all the things that I achieved.
Shania Twain!
Shania Twain!
Shania Twain! Yes!
The records that were broken, I was doing fantastic. And it fell by the wayside. For some reason, I'm not comfortable singing in front of people anymore. I have lost my ability to sing. I've lost it. Don't expect more. Day. This is amateur night. I need to sing again. It wasn't one crisis that made me lose my voice. It was my childhood poverty, my parents' death. I was a workaholic, and my marriage was falling apart. My own friend had an affair with my husband. What if I can never sing again? Never been so miserable in my whole life. I just had to snap out of it. So I'm getting out on this tour, trying to find my voice again. I want to talk to people that have been through similar struggles.
My husband left with my best friend.
I wanted what she had.
She trusted you. I'm taking myself out of my comfort zone.
Stop sugarcoating it. That was, like, so private. Why don't you scare the heck out of yourself and go sing a song with Lionel Richie?
I will be inspired by other people.
The more you do it, the stronger you're going to get.
Share my own experience.
Our own parents have died this year, actually.
Maybe that will inspire them.
Exactly.
The people I brought with me are the people that I really love and trust.
Let's go then.
Life's two most important questions are why and why not. The trick is knowing which one to ask. We are now on the second leg of my journey. We are on our way to Huntsville. Huntsville is a small little place between my hometown of Timmins and Toronto.
Very spectacularly beautiful.
That was too nice. Huntsville was a real transitional time in my life between the loss of my parents and my career taking off. When my parents died, I had two minor brothers still at home, and I wasn't sure how we were going to economically cope. And there is no way that live singing in a bar is going to support a teenage family. And I needed to decide whether I even wanted to carry on with my music career. But a friend of mine said, please don't quit singing. There is a gig in Huntsville at this place called Deerhurst. I can thank that job for keeping me in music.
See you guys at rehearsal.
You're beautiful. Right?
Today is your day, so you know. How do you like my hair?
My job at Deerhurst was a stage production, dance sort of off-Broadway type, Vegas style sort of thing that I had never, ever seen before in my life and was musically in another world. Performing at Deerhurst really took me out of myself because I had never worn high-heeled shoes before. I'd never worked with dancers.
And never mind try to look graceful. So the show was completely out of my comfort zone.
The Huntsville job at Deerhurst is reminiscent of a very unstable and scary time in my life, which is exactly where I am now.
Woo! But I did get discovered here.
Amazing performance that was, by the way.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, I was there. Oh. It was just magnificent. I mean, your sequin dress you were in, and you came walking down. Wind Beneath My Wings.
Yeah.
Right from the first note, I just knew that this was, you know, going to change her life.
It's just ironic. that I've sort of gone full circle back to a scary point in my life. I'm back on the stage. I'm scared again. I'm struggling and my voice is choked. And on purpose, I'm standing on this stage to now face this new fear.
I need a marker, a black Sharpie.
But if I want to sing again,
thank you,
and enjoy it, I have no choice but to put myself through this.
Life's gonna kick you around, then kick you again when you're down. Should it be kick you again while you're down?
I think when, but that's...
Yeah, because you kick somebody when they're
better.
Down, right?
Sings
yeah.
Better too.
Not while they're down, when they're down, yeah.
When they're down,
okay. When you're down, while you're down.
Yeah, when you're down,
that's
okay.
Good.
I felt comfortable being creative, you know, being able to get into the songwriting mode at that moment with everybody being there and listening to my thoughts and ideas. I don't feel inhibited that way. It was more the performance side that I realized, wow, I'm way more insecure than I than I want to be.
Let's see if I get this right. When somebody throws sticks and stones, all they can break are your bones. Life's gonna kick you around and kick you again when you're down. I said today is your day and nothing can stand in your way. Today, yeah, today.
Excuse us. This is amateur night. Hello?
Okay. I'm not really into it.
Well, let's do the... Don't worry. Don't worry.
Which one?
Don't worry, be happy.
Oh.
Yeah. Here's a little song I wrote. I'm gonna play it note for note, so don't worry. Be happy. Can you always sing with me? Ooh, it's too slow. Yeah.
One, did I have the
two.
Top note?
I did.
Oh.
This is just not happening. You know what's wrong? Is that it's a very dry
it's
room.
Yeah. I'm kind of like,
Okay.
Being on the stage at Deerhurst was a real eye-opener. I thought I would be inspired, but I felt like I was starting over. I thought, oh, yeah, I used to come out here and belt out these songs and get standing ovations, and here I am sitting here doing this simple little song, and I just can't get it out.
How about A Course of Country Roads before we go? Do you know that?
Yeah, of course I know it, but...
Okay.
Country roads, take me home to the place I belong. West Virginia, mountain mama, take me home.
Yeah, forget it.
Okay.
I don't think we have it.
Okay.
Can't have it every day.
No.
No.
And you know, it's not a performance, it's a rehearsal.
Exactly.
I think we've had enough for today. Sorry, guys.
Okay.
It was sad for me because I thought, wow, I can sing sometimes. This environment is not one of them. My voice isn't there. And that made me realize that I'm not ready to sing live.
Yeah.
I don't think this is possible. I'm just never gonna sing again.
Why does this suck for you?
The room's too dry and we're too far apart for a dry room. Way too big for us.
The sound
was very intimidating.
Yeah.
I think that's what it is.
Okay.
I don't know. And maybe I'm like just choked or something today. I'm not really sure. My voice won't open up.
What's the matter with me? Why can't it just come out?
What's happened is she's kept the emotions in there and everything in there for so many years. Now I think her voice just won't open up.
I mean, you know what? Normally when you get up to sing, you gotta be this consistent every day. And you're supposed to be good all the time. There are so many ways self-confidence can get destroyed. Expecting too much from yourself. You set your expectations too high. You're setting yourself up for disappointment.
Yesterday it's so easy to get into the moment.
Yeah,
into the
I found
vibe.
It harder today,
you know? It was almost like, like you said.
But it sounded great,
nothing.
Huh?
It's like,
sounded great.
Yeah?
Maybe that's how you felt on that stage, but it was great.
I couldn't really find the drama there. I couldn't find the emotion.
No, and you said it. You said it right.
It was a transition in my life, but it wasn't particularly an emotional one.
Yeah.
Difficult one, but it was just life there and on.
I felt like I hadn't made any progress yet. From that moment on, I realized how much of a challenge this was going to be.
I did discover the affair in a quite concrete way.
I was like the child whose dog got run over by a car and nobody wanted to tell me.
We're heading to my old songwriting cabin on Lake Kanagamisi.
Every time I come here, especially flying in, I'm coming back to something very familiar. You know, it feels very much like a refuge for me.
When I got my recording contract, it was a very humble beginning.
I had one little check from the label. Who knows how long that needed to last. I'd left my full-time singing job at Deerhurst. I needed to travel back and forth to Nashville. But I couldn't afford to move there and live there.
And I came to the end of parenting. The kids were growing up. I was on my own, really, for the very first time.
Can you come over here?
So when I spent time at this cabin, I was basically in between worlds.
Oh, it smells like firewood in here. It's great.
The reason I was in that cabin is because I didn't have anywhere else to go. I had to work part-time at Sears, and the days that I wasn't working, I came out here to the cabin. I had started writing the songs that I recorded for The Woman in Me. I was just in the middle of nowhere, didn't know really what I was heading into. I certainly didn't have any clue that I was ever going to even make it. When you're poor and you grow up really struggling, making it to me was not becoming like a big, wow, mega star rich. Making it was just eating well.
Do you ever wish for the simplicity?
Yeah, I do. Yeah, sometimes I wish for a smaller life. In fact, I'm always wishing for a smaller life. I like a small life. My life is always too big for me. It's been too big for me for a very, very long time. So coming back to this little cabin, it's a good reminder of where I'm from and who I am. Once I got my recording contract, which was such a huge leap from what I was doing in Canada musically, it really took off quickly after that.
You gotta dance with the one that brought you.
So in a 2.5 year period, my life had completely changed.
Mutt became my partner in every sense.
The creative relationship between us was instant. The romantic relationship started through songwriting. I'd have to say that that was really at the root of our relationship.
Look at all the songwriting. I really love this part. I had never co-written anything before I met Mutt. I'd written everything myself.
That's both my and Mutt's handwriting. And that's a lot of Mutt handwriting there.
We were like a musical duo, really. And he was just behind the scenes, and I was the upfront person, but we were collaborating all the way. Worked. It just really worked for a long time. All of it really worked. In you.
Let's go, America!
The Come On Over tour was a fantastic and amazing time in my life. I'm feeling all kicked out of Nashville at the time. Of course I wanted to know what my limits were. Of course I wanted to see where my music took me. My life really got so great. But I think I was too naive to be intimidated and afraid of where I was headed. My marriage was in trouble.
I discovered the affair in a concrete way.
I've been pushed off my own bus while it was going full speed ahead. After the Come On Over tour, I took some time from traveling and doing concert touring.
It's been a long time since I've been up on the concert stage. I want to say hello to everybody at home. It's been 3.5 years since I've been up here.
And then the Up Tour was a very, very challenging tour. My schedule was nuts. 4 a.m. till midnight. Days and days on end, weeks and months on end of non-stop working, promoting, touring, recording. So all I was for a long time was a professional person. And sometimes it does get overwhelming. It's very demanding. It's demanding on your personal life, it's demanding physically, it's demanding professionally. I was feeling more pressure from my career, the bigger it got. I wasn't doing any one thing well. I just wasn't living up to what I should have. Just that scared me more than anything, I think, really.
I mean, I obviously knew she was breaking down. She was taking whatever problems she was or wasn't having with her voice, with her life, and just keeping it all inside and just working.
Here we go.
I was a workaholic, and Mutt was a workaholic. So then, because of the nature of our independent careers, there were a lot of times that we weren't together. And I was very lonely, to be honest.
I wish back then I would have been a little more forceful and got in her face and said, okay, really, what is going on? What is going on?
I was slowly losing my voice and slowly losing my confidence. Now, of course, my marriage was slowly breaking down, too. I'd lost touch with my personal life. My marriage was in trouble. You know, communication just started dropping out of the relationship. What ended up happening was that I just lost touch with my husband.
My ex-wife started to work for them, and that's how we got to know them.
Fred and Mutt were good friends, and Marianne and I were good friends. She was my confidant, somebody who understood what my concerns were in my marriage.
Mutt was acting strangely. And so I said, Marianne, don't you think that my husband is acting strange? And she said, no, I don't see anything strange. I think he's fine. You know, I was putting a lot of pressure on communicating with my husband. And so I forced the issue. Of course, when I forced it, then that conversation ended with, it's over between us. All Marianne did through the whole thing was comfort me, telling me that everything was fine. And I believed her and I accepted it as being genuine. She's a great actress. She deserves an Academy Award. I really believed her that she was being sincere and genuine and a really good friend. I remember so clearly my friend sat across from me with our children playing beside us on the floor, comforting me. She put her hand on my arm and said, I don't know where you find the strength.
I did discover the affair with my wife and Mutt in a quite concrete way. I don't want to go into the details of that because I don't think it's necessary.
I was like the child that, you know, whose dog got run over by a car and nobody wanted to tell me.
I said, guys, now you have to tell her. This is ridiculous. You just owe her that. And they didn't want to do it. So I had to tell her.
You're wrong. I'm telling you, you're wrong. She's not having an affair with Mutt.
She gave them the benefit of the doubt immediately.
And when I asked her the direct question, when I said, what is going on? Then she got very defensive and said, how could you think such a thing that I would ever lie to you about anything? The whole innocent friend, even with a tear in her eye.
She questioned both of them again, and she found out the truth. And like I said, there was just no doubt about it, you know?
Then that was it. I lost it.
It's terrible. She was really heartbroken, you know? And she was really, really heartbroken.
I was grieving the death of friendship, the death of love. I was grieving the loss of anything innocent, really.
She never expected that in 10 million years, you know.
How could I be so stupid? I really didn't see that coming. I've been pushed off my own bus while it was going full speed ahead into the dirt. When you come out of that tumble, you are lost. I need a grief education, man. Can't we just do some things on our own? Does everybody really need a therapist?
I mean, why do you have to always be strong?
When I found out about the affair, I was in real shock. There were days where I really just was like, you know, I just don't even really care if tomorrow comes. It was extremely, extremely painful. But I think that it's more multifaceted than just the end of my marriage and betrayal. It's all of the crisis experiences of my life. I was feeling stuck. So I threw myself into reading a lot. I needed grief education, man.
That is the book about the man who lost his two sons. No?
Both his sons. Both. Dr. Livingston specializes particularly in grief. He was my therapist without realizing it. He gave through his work, through his experience, and so through sharing it, I learned from that. And I said to myself, well, that's what I want to do. And so he really was a catalyst for me to give through my own experience and help others.
Okay, Okay, I'm a little bit nervous.
Well, of course you are. I would worry a little bit if you were.
So now
I'm going to come face to face with the man that's been guiding me through a very difficult time.
I'm nervous because I don't know, I've just never had a therapist before, so I don't even know what to do. That's a good reason to be nervous. My throat is choking. I mean, there's something wrong with the way I deal with the crises that do come up in my life.
I just want to welcome you to our little bus here, our house.
Yeah, it's quite a bus.
It's actually pretty special, isn't it?
Yeah,
it's
it is.
Pretty fancy.
It is.
I just want to, you know, sit here and try to be myself and let you be the professional, because you know a lot more about this than I do, and that's kind of why I've invited you here. You know, I noticed that particular note in your book heading, life's two most important questions are why and why not. The trick is knowing which one to ask. So for whatever reason, I've adopted this attitude, and I do live by it every day. I believe in it.
Okay. I think you have to ask yourself, well, what is the objective of this process?
Well, first of all, I'm afraid to make a fool of myself and to admit that I've got this nonsense going on in my mind that I just can't get over, the fact that my friend knew that she was going to hurt my family but did it anyway. I have a hard time with that.
This person that you're angry with turned out to be someone other than you thought. That's a misjudgment. You made a mistake. Well, in life, we have to pay for our mistakes.
Yes.
And what you're feeling now is your payment. Accepting responsibility is a step on a path toward forgiveness. Not just forgiveness of the other person, but forgiveness of yourself as well for having made this mistake.
Yes, I did definitely misjudge my friend.
And your husband.
And my husband. You know, my ex-husband is a wonderful person. He's a kind and generous man. He's a great father. He's just a beautiful person. I can genuinely say that.
But he hurt you, Shania.
He did hurt me. But you know what? I hurt people too sometimes.
But I think you're trying to protect your relationship with him, understandably, because you have a son together and you've got to continue to parent him. And
I guess I'm just not really ready to sit down and allow the anger part of our relationship to take over.
You've always been a strong person, and you try to convey that to everybody. And so I think that in some ways you haven't allowed yourself to experience this fully.
I definitely have not cried enough. I admit that. I'm trying to make up for it with laughing. Does that count?
No, it doesn't.
Does it count?
That's just another
defense.
Can
you laugh instead of crying? Well, I don't like crying. I do like to avoid it.
Because you associate that with weakness, right? I mean, someone would think less of you for it.
Yes, that is a part of it.
This is a terrible life-altering circumstance, and that has to be grieved and has to be acknowledged.
That's what Fred and Carrie say to me all the time.
I just think that you're being more brave than you have to be. It's affected your voice.
It has. And the feeling you get when you want to cry, but you fight it and you get all choked up, it's as if now I permanently have that feeling, whether I want to cry or not. And I really need to do something about it.
I think you ought to think about getting some help from somebody on a regular basis, you know, someone who
you could,
someone who can help you through this. It's the kind of thing that can't be worked through in one conversation.
Well, the reason I've kind of thrown myself out to do this is because I just felt that I was obsessing.
You have to be patient with yourself, Shania. It's going to take a little time. You do know that you're going to get through it, and you do know that there's something better for you on the other side.
Yeah.
Good.
It was very therapeutic for you, and that's what I think, you know.
You know what you really need is to see somebody regularly.
You have a need to talk about, you know, everything, not only what happened to you with, you know, your friends, but also what happened to you.
Able to release that. I believe that if she lets things out and works on letting her emotions out, that she will find her voice. you lose a child, you got to really concentrate on your marriage. And my husband left with my best friend.
We are on our way to meet Marie, who is a friend of my sister's. And she has a very similar story to me, having experienced the betrayal of a very close friend with her husband, with the added layer of also losing two children prior to that.
You know, I've been actually for a very long time wanting to get together with you. It's the same thing that happened to you, basically, that my very close friend was having an affair with my husband. So I'm forcing myself out of my comfort zone, and I think it just makes me feel better to talk about it a lot.
Definitely.
And to share it a lot.
Definitely, yeah.
Let's talk about what happened to you. You know, how long were you married for?
21 years. I thought we had the perfect family.
So you have four children together.
Yes, number two and number four have passed away. We had lost my first son in 1993 with SIDS.
Oh, premature death is really hard, and shocking death.
Yes, agony.
You get through that grief together. Did you feel even that that made you stronger?
Oh, yes. When you lose a child, you got to really concentrate on your marriage.
Mm-hmm.
Got through that and had another child. Fourth son, he was born in 2000. And then he passed away in 2004. He was hit by a car.
Oh. Losing your son, that's like the most disastrous thing that could happen to anybody. You know it twice over. Honest to goodness.
Definitely a different type of pain. The main thing I was thinking was to hold it together myself for my kids.
Yes.
Okay, how am I going to get them through it? My best friend that actually is with my husband now, I thought she was helping me.
Yeah,
Keep it together. She always said to me, you know, I wish I had a family like yours. Love your family and, you know.
I mean, that's just creepy.
No, she did.
That is just so creepy to even hear that. You know,
And just bang. By 2006, I guess they were having an affair. My husband left with my best friend.
I don't know how on earth any human being could ever have an affair with your husband, knowing that you're both struggling after the death of your child. I can't understand it.
No excuse for what they did to
yes,
me.
Yeah.
But marriages end every day. It's the way you end them that
yes,
is the main thing.
Exactly. So how do you find peace then?
Release the anger.
Well, yes.
It's a huge thing for me.
Okay, but how did you release the anger? Because, I mean, if
counseling.
Counseling?
Oh, gosh.
You can be my counselor.
I'm very shy, and I'm not a talker, and I was forced to talk.
I would really like to avoid crying and breaking down. And I, you know, I just know that if I do that route.
You feel so much better after.
I don't know why I'm so against crying. Before the crisis in my marriage, I never talked about any aspect of my life that was personal with anyone, not even Carrie, my sister. Why are you okay talking about it?
Talking about it works through your problems so that it makes moving on better. And my husband now, he forced me and now I'm a talker.
Isn't that amazing?
If you would have told me that I would be getting married again, I would have told you were crazy. Absolutely not. I'll never, ever commit like that again.
And I feel childish, but I said the same thing.
And life is amazing.
And life is amazing.
Yep.
It was great for me to sit down with Marie. It helped me a great deal to hear her perspective. She had different points of view on some things, and I got a lot out of that. A big part of my therapy is being adventurous, taking myself out of my comfort zone. And this time I'm taking Marie with me. We're gonna take that plunge and jump out of an airplane together. We're gonna experience something very unique. We are throwing caution to the wind, literally, and we are just saying, all right, life, here I am. There's a lot of liberation in that.
I've been in a glider, I've been in a helicopter, I've never skydived.
Right, so you've done all those other things, so why not?
Absolutely.
Why not just go one step further?
Yeah.
And just throw yourself out of a plane?
I'll let the guy behind me do that.
Hello? I don't know who to say hello first.
Welcome.
Hello.
Welcome to the Concert.
Thank you, Joe. It's lovely to meet you. Yeah.
You've done it before, right?
I have done it before, but it doesn't help.
I know you're scaring me.
No. Hold on, wait a minute. I'm more anxious because I know what to expect. But when you don't know what to expect, you say, well, this is something I've decided to do. Why not do that? I'm just going to go for it. And that's a beautiful thing. But I don't always have control, and I don't need to always have control. And even if what I think on the other side might be scary, I can't let that stop me. Death or serious injury. That was the risk. There's nothing else you need to know. Oh my God! So Marie and I are going to jump out of an airplane and share the experience together.
Before I let her go on that jump, you know, beautiful woman, I'd like to know what are the risks, Ray.
No, we already know. Death or serious injury. Those are the risks.
Oh, okay.
Just
that's
bottom
fine,
line. There's nothing else you need to know. I think the bravest aspect about doing something like this is the fact of just saying, I can throw caution to the wind sometimes, and I can do things that are a little bit scary, and trust that what will be will be.
So what happens if you don't open the chute?
You will.
I will, of course. My wife is still waiting for me, I hope. So I'll open the chute. You just have fun.
The exercise of sharing and going through an experience of fear together is just a very bonding thing to do. I'm actually really good with these things. I've never vomited before on a high
velocity. Good, let's keep it that way.
High velocity event.
Right foot in there. Excellent. And left foot in there.
Carrie, stop biting your nails.
Not the nails, the fingers.
Carrie's very worried.
We're inviting change. We're inviting experience. We're inviting forward motion.
We're going to remember this forever.
I'm not a very patient person.
No, you know what? I get it. I feel the same way. It's all the anticipation. If he forgets to pull, would one of you please come and pull?
Pull?
You can do that, right? It's my last chance! One more week! Where are my people that I love?
It's about as bad as it could be. Seems everybody's bugging me. Like nothing wants to go my way. Yeah, just ain't been my day. Nothing's coming easily.
I can hear you scream, but I'm okay. Are you ready, girl?
It's about as bad as it could be. Seems everybody's bugging me. Like nothing wants to go my way.
If I check you out?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, are you okay? Oh my gosh.
Let me suggest you just stay there, okay?
Do you want to leave this on?
She just needs to cool down.
She's overheating big time, so.
Yeah.
Okay. It was just a hard land.
Okay.
So it might just take 5 minutes, or however long it takes. When you feel good, we'll help you up and away we can go. Other than the landing, how was it?
Ha ha ha.
awesome. It was really
cool. No, just hold that.
Marie had a really rough landing. Luckily, she was okay.
I need more. Yay,
Marie! When this journey came about, I thought of Marie. We're two completely different people, and our paths cross through a common personal crisis.
Thank you. That was awesome. Wasn't that awesome?
It was.
This is what brings people together, and this is how we learn from each other, by hearing it from somebody who's experienced it.
I'm so glad we did it.
I was inspired by her bravery. I mean, her story is moving and powerful, and I appreciated it.
This is a strong chick over here. She is. She's a strong lady.
It helped me a great deal to hear her perspective. I'm not going out there to convince anybody of anything. I'm totally open to being convinced myself. No matter who you are, we all have to
be fine.
What is going through the mind of the traitor?
I would chew somebody's arm off if they had what I wanted.